Well, good morning to Europe. Hello, good evening from Australia. Let me just begin, if I may, just briefly by acknowledging the traditional owners of the lands from which I present, the Turrbal and Jagera people, and acknowledge their elders, past, present, and emerging, and also acknowledge that these unceded lands have always been places of teaching, research, and learning. This is a very brief presentation that's related to my book, which would have been quite recent if ECREA had been held in 2020 and is now another year older, Are Filter Bubbles Real? So I'll take you through the key arguments of this book essentially in this presentation. Why are we even talking about filter bubbles and echo chambers? Well, they pop up in all sorts of places, even in presidential farewell addresses, where Barack Obama said that, especially on our social media feeds, it's very easy to retreat into our own bubble. So this is a term, these are concepts that are very widespread and very widely used now. They go back as far as internet culture is concerned, perhaps to early cases like Negroponte writing about the Daily Me, at that point actually in a very positive sense that, you know, newspapers could be personalized to the actual interests of their readers. So he was quite positive at that point, but fairly quickly, people like Cass Sunstein, who popularized the idea of echo chambers across a series of books, and Eli Pariser, who came a little bit later to talk about filter bubbles, have pointed out some of the potential negative repercussions of these supposed concepts. And the idea here is always that echo chambers or filter bubbles are essentially removing the shared basis of information across society. They keep us from being equally informed, and therefore we make the wrong choices, or we simply are, society is fragmenting into different areas. But there's a problem with all of this, because very, very little of the research and very little of the writing that's out there about echo chambers and filter bubbles actually ever bothers to define what they are. So where do we find them? At first, when we talk about filter bubbles particularly, there's talk about general search engines like Google. Pariser starts his idea of filter bubbles with an anecdote that he asked two friends to Google the same thing. They found different results, so they must be in different filter bubbles. And that's really what his entire edifice is based on. There's other other cases where we're talking about more specific search engines and portals and recommender systems. And of course, more recently, the focus has shifted very strongly towards social media. But there too, we need to ask, well, what kind of social media, what platforms? We've just heard about the different platforms, of course, from Stina. And where on these platforms as well, around profiles, around pages, hashtags, groups, there are many different communicative formations on these platforms, of course. Also, what exactly are we looking for? What exactly constitutes a filter bubble and echo chamber? Very few of the articles that talk about these things actually ever define them. So in order to be in a filter bubble or echo chamber, do you need to be hermetically sealed off from the rest of the world, just with your equals, just talking about your kind of information, your kind of ideas, as the image on the right there symbolizes? Do you just need to be in groups of hyper-partisans, but maybe still connected to some extent to the outside? Or is any kind of politically partisan community already an echo chamber and filter bubble? In which case, basically any interest group would be an echo chamber or filter bubble. Any political party would be an echo chamber or filter bubble. And why exactly do these things exist if they do? Again, there's a few different arguments. There is an argument that's based around human factors, polarization among citizens. There's an argument that's based around technological factors, that, you know, algorithms place us into different publics. And of course, there's a feedback loop between the two and some of the arguments as well. But again, how do we define these things? A lot of the argument has been based on so-called common sense, on, you know, the anecdotes that Pariser talks about, for instance, rather than any real empirical evidence. And of course, the people who've been popularizing these terms have not been media and communication scholars either. Cass Sunstein is a legal scholar. Eli Pariser is, well, he calls himself an activist and tech entrepreneur. So they're not people who necessarily have a deep knowledge of media studies and a deep history in media studies. This, I think, is problematic. Now, in the book, I define echo chambers and filter bubbles with these definitions, where echo chambers are based particularly around patterns of connection, and filter bubbles are defined particularly around patterns of communication, which of course are distinct, particularly in social media contexts. You can take or leave these definitions. I'm not saying that they're necessarily the only definitions, but in order to actually talk about these concepts, we do need to have definitions, of course, to talk about them. And what this leaves open, quite deliberately, is of course the question of whether these come into existence, if they do, based on algorithmic curation, so based on the tools that we're using, or personal choice, or a mix of both of those. So what then is the evidence actually for these mysterious objects to exist? Well, early research, and we can go back there to the early 2000s, for instance, found some evidence of what Adamage and Glantz, in this famous paper about the blogosphere in the 2004 US election, called mild echo chambers. So they found that blogs were linking preferentially, of course, to their own side, Democrats to Democrats, Republicans to Republicans, which is not particularly surprising, it has to be said, with less connection between the two sides. They call that mild echo chambers. But we can ask, of course, here, well, if they're still connecting to each other, how bad can the impacts of this be? Is that not just what political partisans have always done pre-digital technology as well? So to what extent is there actually a problem for society, unless that connection in the middle that's shown here in yellow or orange is severed entirely, which clearly here it isn't. More recent work has often focused on Twitter, of course, but some of the work on Facebook is showing similar patterns. Here's an example that I think is quite emblematic by Williams et al. From 2015 of a number of different climate change related hashtags on Twitter. And they've looked here at following networks, retweet networks, and mention networks. And paradoxically, they found what they call both open forums, where people from different sides of the debate are talking to each other, and echo chambers where they're not. In different hashtags, and in fact, in different elements of Twitter as a platform. So we're seeing here the follower networks tend to be quite polarized often. The retweet networks also tend to be fairly polarized, but the mention networks, particularly there in the AGW hashtag, you see a lot of interaction actually between the two sides. So can you both be in an echo chamber of disconnection as far as follower networks go, and the filter bubble, and not in the filter bubble as far as interaction goes? That seems difficult to me. So we're seeing here, of course, some different aspects of these platforms where we see different patterns. And of course, these hashtags don't exist in isolation on these platforms either. So it's very difficult, again, to say that there would be any really significantly negative effects from people not following each other, but still talking to each other. And of course, we see other evidence that also points in the opposite direction. Social media surveys, for example, around the 2016 US election, said that people self-reported that they encountered a mix of beliefs on their social networks, both pro-Trump and pro-Clinton. And in fact, to the point of exhaustion, where they're actively trying to disconnect from people who had a different opinion from their own, but couldn't. So they were frustrated by the amount of cross-connection across the political camps. More recently, a study for the last German election showed that the followers of the pages of political parties in Germany were still connecting with each other around other interests very significantly, except for the followers of the neo-fascist far-right party, the AfD, who were basically just connecting around anti-immigrant and other far-right topics. So other than that particular hyper-partisan group, there's actually a significant connection still amongst these mainstream users. And work that we've done in 2016, just mapping the Australian Twitter sphere, follower connections, again, showed a significant interconnection between different groups. There were a handful of clusters that were quite disconnected, often for very obvious reasons. There's a porn cluster that doesn't connect with anything else. But as far as politics goes and news goes, there is actually very significant interconnection across political camps and other interests as well. So even then, when we go back to search, filter bubbles and search, where really the idea of filter bubbles started, with a lot of recent research, whether that's at mid-scale, where people created fake accounts and searched from them using different fake profiles, or in fact borrowed the profiles of real users, they found that search largely presents in the US just a handful of major news sites as results. And Neochta and Lewis actually here said that it would be nice if search gave a broader variety of results rather than just these mainstream outlets all the time. Another study by Algorithm Watch in Germany found that on searches for political leaders and parties, mostly the search results were practically identical in 5 to 10% of cases, even in the same order. So again, no filter bubbles in search there, even with 1,500 or so people from very different walks of life donating their search results on these topics. So here again, we see no evidence of filter bubbles in search. Now, why would that be if we are not, if we've been talking about filter bubbles and echo chambers so much, why would we not actually see them in the evidence? Well, in the first place, a lot of the work in social media that's tried to identify echo chambers and filter bubbles has actually focused only on individual hashtags or pages. And of course, yes, some of those hashtags might be very ideologically pure. If you're going to the MAGA hashtag on Twitter, then you see lots of MAGA supporters, lots of Trump supporters. But of course, as we've just heard from Stina as well, these are not just on their own platform, but also in other platforms, embedded in a really complex platform structure as well. So they don't exist in isolation, but the people who are on those hashtags are navigating the media manifold that Stina's talked about. And of course, most people who are on these platforms aren't even particularly political in the first place, but are connecting on many other topics as well. So while people might gravitate towards others who have similar interests and similar opinions and maybe similar backgrounds to them, it doesn't mean that we're also actively avoiding news or information that disagrees. Homophily doesn't mean heterophobia. And largely, I think what we see in the literature, sometimes described as echo chambers, tend to be just communities of interest, where people, yes, gravitate together, but not actively disconnect from other aspects of the platform. And in fact, again, in a media manifold, cross-ideological connections are practically impossible to avoid. While on a single Facebook page, you might find people who are like you, on your Facebook profiles and other parts of the platform, you find context collapse, and that's been very well documented. And of course, this goes well across Facebook only. Where people like Parisa keep talking about, well, we only connect with our political compadres, we only connect with people who have the same political interests as us. Well, the reality is that most people actually couldn't care less about politics when they choose their Facebook friends or their Twitter followers. So politics is quite significantly overrated, I think, by these authors as a reason for making connections on social media. Now, it is possible to form what we might call hard echo chambers and filter bubbles that are exclusive of everyone else, but it's actually very rare, because you'd really have to, again, thinking of what Stina's just presented, you'd really have to disconnect from a lot of platforms where you don't find that level of ideological purity. It's a very cultish kind of approach to connecting with others, where you only connect with others that are ideologically pure. Now, that's possible if you only frequent some of the platforms that have been designed that way, 4chan, 8chan, Gab, Parler, and so on. But even there, the hyper-partisans that exist on these platforms from the far right and sometimes from the far left are also actually heavy users of mainstream news, sometimes just in order to criticize what's in mainstream news coverage, but they're still actually following mainstream news with a great deal of attention as well. So even they are not disconnected and not unaware of what the other side thinks or what the mainstream thinks. So in many ways, what emerges here is that filter bubbles and echo chambers tend to be a very techno-determinist concept. Humans are more complicated than these concepts are allowing us to be. Our networks, particularly for those of us who are not only talking about politics, are very diverse, they're complex, they're inconsistent. They go across political lines. Politics is just a small part of what people are actually interested in. And of course, the algorithms have to try and keep up with all of those interests, not just with our political interests. So if you put all of this together and you have people who still follow mainstream information sources, you have the random serendipity that exists, of course, across social media as well, you end up with a fairly mixed information diet, whether you want it or not. So these terms, these echo chamber and filter bubble terms, tend to be typical examples of moral panics that have always emerged when new technologies come along. They're based on anecdotal personal evidence rather than empirical evidence. They significantly overestimate the power of AI to filter us all into these pure groups. And that power of AI has been overestimated at least since Negroponte in 1995. We still don't have the daily me being made available to us. This is, as Weinberger says, a myth just waiting to concretize into common wisdom. By now, arguably it has, because we see these terms being bandied around so much. But they are, of course, very handy for attacking social media platforms. Now, don't get me wrong, there's many reasons to attack social media platforms, but echo chambers and filter bubbles are probably one of the least sensible ones. So I actually agree with this journalist, Sebastian Meineck, who said that the filter bubble is the dumbest metaphor on the internet. It just doesn't hold out in the evidence. And it keeps us from seeing the more important challenges. The question is not what people encounter. They encounter many different things on these platforms, but what they end up doing with it and how they choose what to do. So to paraphrase Weinberger, this is what he said in 2004, the problem with an extraterrestrial conspiracy mailing list isn't that it's an echo chamber, it's that it thinks there's a conspiracy by extraterrestrials. Now, after the events of the last few years, we could say the problem isn't that there are hyperpartisan echo chambers or filter bubbles, it's that there are hyperpartisan fringe groups that fundamentally reject, actively fight any mainstream societal and democratic consensus, not because they're in filter bubbles, but because they genuinely believe that this is what they want to be doing. So the problem here is political polarization. It's not communicative fragmentation via the technologies themselves. There is no echo chamber or filter bubble. The filter is in our, or possibly in their heads. And this is the problem, I think, that we urgently need to address. So I'll leave it there. I hope that was about 15 minutes, and I look forward to discussion. Thank you.